I don't like pop-under ads, and as a Chrome user, I'm happy that Google agrees with me. They consider them to be bugs in their pop-up blocker. I made a few videos a few months back where we have reverse engineered one particular obfuscated JavaScript library used and sold to advertisers in order to figure out the trick they use, and then reported it to Google to get the bugs fixed. Back then, it has also motivated Masato Kinugawa to research a few more techniques, and overall we killed quite a few bugs that allowed pop-unders. And I think we were quite successful. For a long time, the pop-under library did not have a working pop-under technique for Chrome and had to resort to a tab-under, which was awesome. For a while, we were the reason why a lot of advertisers that used this script couldn't create terrible pop-under ads on Chrome. But now, I was made aware by Silent Hammer on the subreddit that the pop-under.js library has been updated and ships now with a working pop-under for the current Chrome version 65 up to the current development version 68. And indeed, the demo works. There is a pop-under. Let's figure out how it's done and then report it as well. The first few steps that I'm doing now are the same like I did in previous videos. I essentially want a local mirror of the script so I can modify them and play around with it. So I use the Chrome Developer Tools to get all the script files loaded by this site and save them. And because of the licensing and this being the demo, and I don't know how the license check works, it might check the hostname, I do not only download all the files, but I also change the etc host file so that the domain points to localhost. Then I use PHP to launch a local web server and serve the files with the same folder structure as the server. Now I have all the files locally and can change them however I want. For example, I can clean them up and beautify the scripts. The files are loaded locally now. And a quick test, yep, the pop-under still works. Okay, so let's have a first look. The JavaScript code is clearly still obfuscated, so nothing we really want to work through statically. And trying to look at the script dynamically with the Chrome Developer Tools is also still super annoying because the script constantly traps the debugger with the debugger keyword. We can disable the debugger and still run it, but then we can't set any breakpoints. If we do want to pause, going up in the calls deck, we can see where this debugger call is coming from, and it's coming from this function A. And there we can see that A is always repeatedly called with set timeout. So we can try to override the set timeout with our own function, which also logs some information about the call. This hopefully disables the debugger traps. When we now reload the page, it looks really good, we don't break. But we also don't see anything in the console, but that's because the code constantly clears the console. Luckily, the developer tools also are cool and just tell us the line where this clear is called. So we can go there, set a breakpoint by clicking the line number, and boom, the debugger breaks here. Now we can analyze the code. Capital I is the window object, the kn variable is the string console, and hn is the string clear. So this simply calls window.console.clear. We can also find this line in our script and can just comment it out. Now when we reload the page, we see exactly the outputs. And as you can see, stuff tried to call set timeout. However, also the pop-under is not working anymore. So I guess I just overwrote it and it didn't help us. Let's revert it back. Another thing we used was the performance tab. This one can be used to record every JavaScript function call. So we can hit record, trigger the pop-under, and hit stop again. Now it takes a moment to gather everything, and here we have it. This is the timeline, and all of these colorful bars are function calls. So here is clearly our start. This is the mouse down event. Later in here we also see an on before open, which is actually a call into the demo.js. So this is a library sold for advertisers, and so the library creator offers here functionality that you can run code just before and after the pop-under was opened. This means our pop-under creation should happen after this one here. Interestingly, the whole function graph stops here now. Not everything happens down in the hierarchy from the mouse down event. There's a weird function call later which at some point results in open. The orange functions are generally regular JavaScript stuff, like events and all the JavaScript functions. And the pink ones are custom ones, so these are the obfuscated functions as you can see from the name. And actually, there are two of these blocks starting from a weird arbitrary function call which result in open. and open is the function to create a new pop-up or tab, so it does it twice. I have actually no clue what triggers this initial function. If it would have been directly called from the mouse down event, it would be part of that block, so that's weird. But looking at this, I don't see anything special. There are no calls to create new HTML elements, nothing external is loaded, it's just these open calls. That's super weird. We can also look at from where the open is called by looking here at the call stack and following that link. So this apparently calls open, and these should be the parameters of open. Let's search for the snippet in the script.js file we have and then add some console log outputs to print the parameters passed to open. We save the new script, reload the page, trigger a pop under and look at the console. So we see two opens. Both have the first parameter about blank and the second one underscore blank. With a look into the API reference for open, we see that this is the URL and this is the name. But the first open has additional optional window features. It defines width, height and stuff like that. The second open didn't have that. Okay, nothing too special here either. While playing around, I also noticed that the anti-debugger trapping is not that aggressive, so we can actually add our own debugger statement here at the open call, reload the page, disable the breakpoints, and then prepare to be super fast, because we can very quickly reactivate the breakpoints, quickly switch to the browser window, hope that the anti-debugging traps don't trigger first, click somewhere to create a pop under and hope that our breakpoint at the open is hit. And that worked, here we are. Now we can see the state of the variables which we already know. We can also see the call stack and have a look at where this call is coming from. Notice how it says here post message async? That will explain a lot later, but when I looked at it the first time, I was just a bit confused. And looking at this function here, we see a variable I, which is a message event object with a data attribute containing our window open parameters. At this point I got a bit frustrated. If you have watched the previous videos, you know what kind of crazy techniques were used to pull off a pop under. I didn't fully trust the developer tools, to be honest, because maybe there are tricks to hide stuff from it. I was expecting something really, really crazy, and I decided to get out the big guns. I wanted to directly look at the native functions being called from JavaScript, so nobody can hide anything. I went to the Chromium sources and followed the checking out and building Chromium for Mac instructions. If you want to follow along and build Chrome as well, make sure you have enough disk space. Not only did it take me overnight to build it, in the end I also needed almost 80 gigabytes disk space for it, so be warned. But that's not too bad, because with minimal changes you don't have to rebuild the whole thing again. It only has to rebuild the part you modified, so that's cool. I also have to give my kudos to the build team or whoever is responsible for this. These instructions just worked. I had no issue at all, it just worked, which I did not expect. Anyway, so I want to log important JavaScript function calls, for example the open call, but also things like createElement or any other API call. All these calls somehow have to be executed by the underlying browser, so you can't fake or hide anything. In the end, these native functions have to be called. It's the first time for me looking at these sources, so I have no clue what I'm doing. But let's maybe think about this for a second. Maybe you have heard of V8. Chrome uses the V8 JavaScript engine. And there is a subdirectory for the V8 engine with the sources. So maybe this is a good point to start? Well, maybe, but probably not. V8 is just JavaScript. We are not really interested in logging when something creates an array or so. We want the APIs that glue together the browser and the JavaScript, and that is mostly the DOM. The document object model is what we can use from JavaScript to interact with the browser and the HTML. However, Chrome also has a lot of other APIs, like the notification request permissions, and these are probably not included in the DOM, but we deal with that when we need to. Let's start with something easy and look for the document create element function. In previous pop under videos, that was a crucial part in the trick, so it would be awesome to log that. And so the DOM is most likely part of the actual browser engine, and in case of Chrome, that would be Blink. I looked around in the huge codebase for a bit and then I found it. Chromium, source, third party, Blink, renderer, core, DOM. So I opened that folder in Sublime and then let's start searching for create element. Oh, we find something in a .h header file. Let's actually restrict to only C++ source code files. So here we go. We find some functions in document.cc, which I think is awesome, because the JavaScript function would be document.createElement. So here we definitely find a lot of important APIs. So, createElement. Here we go. Entry point of createAnElement. That sounds perfect. So I guess this is the native C++ function being called when you call document.createElement in JavaScript. Let's test that. Let's add a simple, recognizable printf here, just so we know if this is being executed. Then we rebuild Chrome, and as you can see, it goes pretty fast now. Only had to build the change we made. And then let's execute our own Chromium build. I also wrote the short test create script that will call createElement whenever we click the link here. But it doesn't seem to work. Damn, no output. It also links here the specification of the HTML living standard that defines these kind of things. And it says here concept create element, so not really sure what that means. But when I searched a bit more in the document.cc source code, I found the create element for binding function, which links to the DOM document create element specification. Okay, this one actually sounds like the correct function. So let's add a printf here. Then we compile Chromium again, open the test page, and we click the button. And awesome, our printf works. Now we have all the power to log every function we want. It might just be a bit tedious to add these printfs everywhere. I played around with it a bit more, added printfs to different kind of functions like getElements by tag name and stuff like that, but it didn't reveal anything new. It just didn't seem to do anything weird. At this point, I decided to sit down and started to implement what I already know. I know 100% that there are two open calls and we know their parameters. We also know that it somehow is all triggered from a onMouseDown event, so let's do that as well. And then we try that. It opens a pop-up, but as expected, it only opens one. The second open call is blocked by the pop-up blocker. The browser allows one user interaction, the click, to open one window, because if the user clicked, then one window is fine, but not a second one. However, let's just for testing disable the pop-up blocker and allow this page to create any pop-ups it wants. When we now try it again, the second open call actually creates a new tab, and the tab gains focus. See, the pop-up at this point is in the background. Let's add a set timer to our script to close a new tab after 1 second again and try that. We click on the link, it opens the pop-up and tab, the main window gains focus, and then the tab is closed when the timeout hits. Boom! We have a successful pop under. Holy crap, this was damn simple. As long as we can open two windows, one pop-up and one tab, we can get focus back to the main window. But with activated pop-up blocker, which is the default, this doesn't work. So the creator of this pop-under script actually found a technique to bypass the pop-up blocker and open multiple windows. And this is where the post message comes into play from earlier. While looking around a bit more, looking at call stacks and stuff, at some point I stumbled over it again and it clicked. Wait, post message? And here's the message data? Maybe the reason why the two open calls were shown in their own function block is because they were on message events, triggered from an asynchronous post message. That totally makes sense. Why didn't I understand that earlier? So I quickly implemented this. I create an onMessage handler which looks at the data and either creates a new pop-up for data 1 or a new tab which is also closed again with 2. And then I simply trigger a post message with 1 and 2 in the pop-under function. This should create both the pop-up and the tab. Let's try that in the browser. Clicking the link, it creates both. Amazing, we bypassed the pop-up blocker. This also means we can spam pop-ups now, if we just keep sending post messages in a loop. Look here. So, now we are done here. I have reported this issue to Chromium and hopefully it gets fixed soon.